在我小的时候，想象中是一个钱长在树上，遍地是黄金的一个国家。1964年10月30号，我在纽约市的港口上岸，第一个晚上我住在我朋友哈林贫民区的一个破旧的公寓里面。让我更吃惊的是，第二天有一群小朋友穿着奇装异服向每家敲门，嘴里喊说 trick or treat trick or treat。 我才知道我对美国的看法是错误的。蒋南京是我大学的情人，他比我晚一年来美国，他来了之后第二年我们就结婚了。我也以为只要两人相爱，我们就会有一个美满和幸福的家庭，没有想到我对婚姻的看法也是错误的。我那个时候不是基督徒，没有圣经的常识和原则去实践牺牲的真爱，更没有耶稣基督的榜样如何做一个丈夫。另外加上我是一个独生子，在中国传统的家庭教会中长大，认为孝顺很重要，比太太还重要。我开始的时候想讨好双方，结果两面都没有讨好，因此今年每月聚集了无数件无法解决的婚姻问题，造成了夫妻之间的关系缺乏互相谅解和互相的关怀。另外加上我生活在一个自我中心的心态之下，我们的婚姻的灾难是难免的。终于在我们两个儿子的鼓励之下，我们开始办理离婚手续。
当我还是个小姑娘的时候，我就梦想将来自己会有一个充满着爱和温暖的家庭，所以心里很害怕有一天我未来的婚姻会失败而走上离婚这条路。和李阳在大学谈恋爱的时候，他真会宠我，也真会疼我，待我像个公主般。但是我们的交往却没有得到爸妈的赞同，无论他们如何极力的反对，我仍然很坚持，认为我们的相爱是真诚而永恒的。当年出国留学是件荣中耀祖的事，而我竟为了爱情放弃 Kansas 大学研究院给我的全额奖学金，与丽阳在 New Jersey 他求学的地方结婚，自己找了份工作好让他专心攻读博士学位。因此从爸妈那得来的不是给我们深深的祝福，而是严厉的指责和愤怒的耳光。蜜月后双方父母对我们这新婚夫妻的要求犹如排山倒海而来，丽阳是个独子，压力更加沉重。我觉得丽阳好像变了一个人，彼此的关怀和爱护渐渐消失。我度过无数失眠的夜晚，第二天一早还得拖着哭得红肿的眼睛去上班。为了两个幼小的儿子，我必须忍耐下去。丽阳学成后，我们将所有的精力全部放在他牙医诊所的事业上。几年后我们得到了大的房子， 豪华的轿车，房地产的投资，表面上看来我样样都有，还有双博士头衔的丈夫，又有两个即将成牙医的儿子，但是我的心灵却是孤独、沮丧、力量的冷漠和疏远，加上彼此不停的争吵，让我感到我们的婚姻已无可挽救，自己是一个完全的失败者，终于走到我从前最害怕的这条路。我以为没有什么会比离婚更痛苦的事会发生在我身上，但是我错了。
同年5月17号，我们的儿子从学校回家跟我们宣布，他说我是同性恋。因为我们夫妻的感情已经到了绝望的地步，因此我没有全心协力和我太太一同去面对这个挑战，反而我不但没有安慰他，反而指责他跟怪他，认为儿子变成同性恋和他有很大的关系。另一方面，从儿子的告白中，我也开始怀疑我们这一家人是不是应该分道扬镳。既然儿子想要去过同性恋的生活，就让他去吧。对儿子和对太太，我已经无能为力去帮助他们，这个家已经到了四分五裂无可挽救的地步。既然大家都觉得生活很痛苦，还不如各自去寻找自己想要的快乐。可是我太太的反应和我完全不一样。
当儿子用几个简单的字对我们说我是同性恋，你不能想象这带给我们多么大的悲伤。我以为用这个最后通牒要他选择亲情或者选择同性恋很危险，他会清醒过来，一定可以改变。儿子没有任何犹豫地回答说，我生来就是同性恋，不可能改变。如果你们不能接纳我，我只有选择离家这条路。他背起背包就走出了家门，这比我听到他死了的消息更难接受，比被一把尖锐的刀刺伤了我更痛。任何词汇都不足以来形容我当时悲伤的程度，又羞耻又愤怒，全身的血液似乎刹那间流出了体外，我瘫痪地跌倒在地上，全身僵硬如冰块。在那极度的悲伤下，没有一个亲人，也没有一个教会的家庭来安慰跟辅导我，没有任何方法可以解决，也没有任何地方去逃避。心想不只是丈夫离弃了我，连跟我最亲近的小儿子，是我生命中唯一的希望，也背叛了我。我到了生命的尽头，世界在我眼前崩溃，我完全没有再继续活下去的理由。因此 我决定要做一件不可思议的事，结束我的生命。第二天，我不告而别的离家出走，买了张单程火车票，计划到路易维尔去见儿子佑轩最后一面，然后去自杀。当时我还没有重生得救，不知道为什么我却想去见一位牧者。于是在上火车前，我去找了牙医学院的校牧，他给了我一本有关同性恋的小册子。就这样，我上了前往路易维尔的火车。相信只有一死两次，可以解决我所有的痛。像一个喜欢看书的我，竟然在火车上开始读那本小册子。神打开了我的心灵，让我明白了耶稣的心肠。为了爱我们，被钉在十字架上的救恩。虽然我们都是罪人，神依然无条件的爱我们。既然神会无条件的爱我，我也应该无条件的去爱我那同性恋的儿子。这时我抬起头来，眼看窗外那一望无际翠绿的原野，骤然间令我惊讶。我一直是一个无神论者，第一次我看到了大自然的美妙。我领悟到世上一定有神。罗马书一章二十节说，自从造天地以来，神的永能和神性是明明可知的，虽是眼不能见，但借着所造之物就可以晓得，叫人无可推诿。虽然我四周的一切都在漠视是神一手创造的，但五十一年来我却盲目地抵制神的真理。对神的存在，我真是无可再推诿。有轻微坚定的声音对我说，你属于我。那位深知我心事并体恤我软弱与需要的神，他知道什么才是我最渴望想听到的。你属于我，这四个字如同医治了我那破碎心灵的良药。到了路易维尔，从那本小册子的背面的一个电话号码联络上一位住在那的退休师母，他辅导了我六个礼拜，带着我查经祷告。我就近租了间有家具设备的公寓，就像一个私人退休班。我如饥似渴般日夜不停地把自己沉浸在神的话语中。原本去路易维尔是要结束我的生命，实际上我的确做到了。今天我最喜爱的经句之一就是加纳太书二章二十节，我已经与基督同钉十字架，现在活着的不再是我，乃是基督在我里面活着。并且如今我在肉身活着，是因信神的儿子而活。他是爱为我舍己，不但我自己已经与基督同钉十字架，我也要将我所爱的家人都带到耶稣的十字架前。
过了六个礼拜，我接到一个电话，是那一位辅导我太太的一位师母的电话，她很兴奋地告诉我说，你太太已经将她的生命奉献给神了，她已经得救了。我听到以后，不但没有为她高兴，反而回答说，这不是好消息，这是我最害怕的噩梦，因为神会站在他那一边，那我更吵不过他了。可是后来我观察，我发觉我太太的改变不是只在星期表现在星期天而已，她的神在各方面都在改变她。她每天早上都用数小时的时间去查经祷告，他拥有一个很大跟充满了活力的信心，他让我觉得他得到的不是宗教，他得到的是耶稣。不知不觉的，神也开始在我身上做工，我就和我太太一起去上教会，朋友也开始邀请我去参加国际圣经研究团契 BSF。 我们开始在神的话语中体验到神的爱，在我们灵命上开始扎根。神的话打开了我心中的眼睛，不久我也将我的生命交托给主耶稣基督。神开始医治我们两个人的婚姻，他恢复了我们从前的感情跟爱情，让我们心灵一体，更和神走得近。这也是神预先要锻炼我们做一个准备，为去应付那个将来会来临更艰难的一场挑战。因为我们的儿子生活在同性恋中越陷越深。
From my childhood years, I did what most Chinese American kids did. Obey your parents, do well in school, and of course,practice piano. I never fit in with the other American boys because I looked different, I acted different, and I had different interests. God had gifted me with music, with sensitivity, but Satan, who can't take away those God-given gifts, can twist the perception of them, and I was viewed and ridiculed as being effeminate. The first time I remember having same-sex attractions,was when I was 9 years old, after I came across pornography at a friend's house. And at such a young age, I was confused and afraid of those feelings. Without any parental guidance on sexuality, those magazines gave me a distorted view of sex, and they soon became my master. Unfortunately, nowadays, pornography has become the master of many youth.And adults. Many of us and many parents don't know how easily accessible it is on the internet and do little or nothing to protect our homes from it. The pornography industry is a multi-billion dollar industry. The combined annual revenue of the major television networks ABC, CBS, and NBC is $6.2 billion.The combined annual revenue of all the sports teams, hockey, baseball, basketball, and football, is $12 billion. But adding those together pale in comparison to the annual combined net revenue of the pornography industry, $57 billion. We're in an all-out war against the pornography industry, And to be honest, we are losing miserably. So what can be done? Well, did you know also that 9 out of 10 children aged 8 to 16 have already viewed pornography on the internet, often by accident while doing their homework? And 1 out of 5 kids aged 10 to 16 have received a sexual solicitation over the internet by a sexual predator. So like I said, what can be done? Wherever we go and speak, we advocate what we call double internet protection. That consists of having an internet filter and an accountability program. A filter blocks sites from being viewed, but an accountability program logs when questionable sites may get through the filter or when they turn the accountability program off. The two programs that my parents and I use on all of our computers can be found at these two websites, K9WebProtection.com and X3Watch.com. And whenever I speak to Chinese audiences, I always have to say this. It's free. So there should be nothing holding us back from putting this on our computers today, this week. So, with pornography fueling my same-sex attractions, I had my first encounter when I was 16 years old, but I kept my feelings hidden through high school, college, and even the Marine Corps Reserves. Then in my early 20s, I started secretly going out to the gay bars right here in Chicago. Then when I moved to Louisville, Kentucky, where I started dental school, I no longer kept it a secret, and I lived openly as a homosexual in the gay community. Spending almost all my free time in the gay clubs, I went from relationship to relationship to relationship, seeking intimacy and happiness, which I found temporarily, but it only left me feeling unfulfilled and unsatisfied. So I began experimenting with drugs. But without much money as a dental student, I supported my habit by selling drugs. And I sold to friends, classmates, and even a professor. You see, I thought that I could live this double life of being a graduate student by day and a promiscuous drug dealer by night. But 4 months before I was to receive my doctorate, the administration expelled me. So my parents flew down from Chicago to Louisville, and I thought they were going to fight to keep me in school. Because my dad, he's a dentist, he knows the dean. But to my surprise, as we sat there with the dean, my mother told him, "It is not important that Christopher becomes a dentist. But what's more important is that Christopher becomes a Christ follower." Imagine a Chinese mother saying that. But she had her priorities straight. So infuriated at my parents, I moved further away from them to the bright lights and big city of Atlanta, Georgia. And there, I quickly took over the drug scene in the gay community, and I became a supplier to other dealers in over a dozen states. In addition, it was nothing for me to have multiple anonymous sexual encounters each and every day. Because according to the world, I had it all. I had money, fame, drugs, and sex. I had exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator. Because in my world, I had become God.
力量和我正在新生命的成长中，完全不知道儿子在吸毒和贩毒，只知道他需要信主得救。我经常打电话给他，总找不到儿子，只能电话留言。他 他从不回电话。有一次他对我说，你如果再提耶稣或者圣经，就别想再看到我。我还是坚持不断，每隔一天寄基督教卡片给他，填满了鼓励的话、经节、赞美诗歌，并且在每一章的结尾，我总一定签上永远爱你的妈妈。他读都不读就丢进了垃圾桶。圣诞节和新年快到了，我们以为寄飞机票给儿子，他会回家来过节。机票寄出后，圣诞夜到了，我到机场接他。那还是在9/11之前，我可以站在旅客下机的走道前等待儿子出现。乘客开始下机，我心里好兴奋。一个个游客从我眼前走过，和他们的亲人拥抱。当最后一个乘客出现，发觉不是儿子时，我兴奋的心情完全没了。知道儿子不在这班机，只好失望的回家。几小时后，我又回到机场接下一班机，但只不过是重复了刚才你发生的情景。我的心情起起落落，直到最后一班机，我才放弃能见到儿子的这个念头。儿子不回家了，我的泪水忍不住落下，独自开车回家。
儿子居然不愿意回家，我们只好飞到 Atlanta 去看他。第二天他就把我们赶出了门。我在临走之前想留一样东西给他，那就是我第一本圣经。他很生气地对我说，我才不要你的圣经，你在做梦，我会看圣经。可是我还是留下给他。可是当我们一出门以后，他就把我的第一本圣经丢进了垃圾箱。很明显地看出他的叛逆是无药可救。在世俗的眼光来看，他是毫无希望。可是我们的神是万能的，他可以用神迹来改变我们的儿子。所以我太太做了一个很大胆的祷告：主啊，用任何方法将这个浪子带回到你的身边。对一个中国母亲来说，这是一个非常冒险的祷告。虽然我们面临逆境，可是我们不存着绝望的心情，是全心全意定睛在神的诺言。同时我们有100多位代祷的弟兄姐妹跟我们一起向神祷告和祈求。之后的7年，每个星期一，我太太从不间断的进食祷告，7年如一日。甚至有一次她进食祷告了39天，每天早上 他都在他祷告的小祷诗里，跪着苦苦地求神去读圣经和祷告。以下是他写的祷告之一：主啊，我要站在您和我儿子的破口之间，直到这场仗打胜为止。主啊，我要站在你和我儿子的破口之间，每天我都要虔诚地为他向你祷告祈求。主啊，我只有一个要求，不要让我心灰意冷而气馁。无论如何的艰难，无论如何的痛苦，我绝不会放弃我这儿子。您更不会。虽然雅典魔鬼千方百计地要毁灭我儿子，我仍要坚持到底，无论要等到何年何月。每当我向你祈求的时候，我已将一切的重担、一切的惧怕和我的泪水全交代在你的手中。
七年的等待，似乎神都没有回应。其实，神是听到了我的祷告，只是没有顺着我的意愿。他的回答是：我要你休息，要知道我是神。回想当年，我求神改变逆境，神确实带来了很多的改变。只是神儿子的改变时间还没来到，神要先让我改变，他要使我那一被更新的生命成为神施舍慈悲怜悯的胜利金牌。阿斯沃千伯斯曾说，我们活在这世上并不是要证明神是个应许祷告的神，乃是要让我们的生命成为神恩典的纪念碑。在我们等候期待的岁月里，神每天亲自带领，让我们一步步地接近他。
Often prayer does not come quickly.And this certainly was not an exception. But my parents were unwavering in their faithfulness to pray on my behalf. Because my mother knew that it would take nothing short of a miracle to bring this prodigal son to the Father. And a miracle is exactly what God did.This miracle came one day with a bang on the door. I opened up the door, and on my front doorstep were 12 federal drug enforcement agents, Atlanta police, and two big German Shepherd dogs. I just received a large shipment of drugs, not my largest, but they confiscated all my money and my drugs, and I was charged with the street value equivalent of 9.1 tons of marijuana. With that amount, I was facing 10 years to life in federal prison. I had started with a bright future among society's finest in academia. and I found myself in the ditch among society's despised in the Atlantic City Detention Center. So I did what everyone does. They make their first phone call. And so I tried to call all my friends. But little did I know that my mom knew as long as I had those type of friends around, I would find no need for God and no need for my parents. And she loves bold prayers. So she prayed specifically that somehow, some way, every single one of my friends would desert me. And on that day, not one answered my collect call. So you mothers out there, beware of your prayers. They'll come true. So I was down to the bottom of the list. Home. And I dreaded making that phone call as I imagined the earful that I was going to get on the other line. But my mother's first words were, "Are you okay?" No condemnation, no berating words, just words of unconditional love and grace. Romans 2:4 says that it's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. It's not God's wrath. It's not God's anger. But it's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. And even on that miserable day, God was pouring out His irresistible grace and drawing me to Himself through the words of my mother. Actually, my mom was excited to get that phone call, if you can believe it or not, because I hadn't called home in years. And she knew without a doubt that this was God's answer to her prayers. So she knew she had to do just as that good old hymn says, "Count your blessings, name them one by one." No matter what the circumstance, no matter what the trial, we have to count our blessings. And as she hung up that phone, fighting back the tears, she grabbed a little piece of adding machine tape and wrote down these first blessings. "Christopher is in a safe place compared to before." And he called home for the very first time. As my years in prison passed, she kept adding to this list of blessings. And this list of blessings is longer and taller than she is. Both sides. Three days later, I was walking around the cell block, and to be honest, I was trying to stay away from those criminals, because I didn't think I was a criminal. And I passed by this garbage can, and I thought, this garbage can represents my life. I was on my way to become a doctor. My dad has 2 doctorates. I had a good life. And now I found myself among common criminals. Trash. And with my head down, I was about to pass by that garbage can. But something on top of the trash caught my eye. I bent over and I picked it up. And it was a Gideon's New Testament. I took that New Testament back to my cell And for the very first time, I opened up that good book and read through the entire Gospel of Mark that first night. But I certainly did not think, okay, this is the answer to all my problems. I thought, I've got an enormous amount of time on my hands, so I better pass it somehow. But as many of you know, what we have in our Bibles is not just ink on paper. What we have in our Bibles is the very breath of God. And it is living and powerful and sharper than any double-edged sword, able to cut through the hardest of hearts, exposing my sin and my rebellion. And I thought things could not get any worse. I was wrong. A couple weeks later, I was called into the nurse's office alone. They handcuffed me, chained my hands around my waist, shackled my feet together. I shuffled into the nurse's office. She sat me down, shut the door behind me, and I could tell something was not right. She was uncomfortably struggling with the words, and she couldn't even give me eye contact. So she resigned to writing something on a small piece of paper, and she slowly slid it across the desk to me. I looked down at the piece of paper, and I saw three letters and a symbol. It read HIV positive.
圣诞节即将来临的一天下午，我接到儿子从监狱打来的电话，听到他那颤抖、微弱的声音。虽然背后掺着吵吵闹闹的杂声，却也掩盖不住他那哀伤、绝望的气息。突然间，我感到天旋地转。自从知道儿子过着同性恋的生活后，我最害怕会发生的噩梦成了真。儿子被判刑六年，这个宣告令我难以接受。进了我的小祷告室，跪在十字架下，我低头，让这首悦耳的歌声不断地在我脑海里重荡。我活了，可无恐。
It is
after receiving that devastating news, I was lying in my bed, and I noticed something scribbled on the metal bunk above me. And it read, "If you're bored, read Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. At the most hopeless point in my life, God was using the words penned by a prophet thousands of years ago to a rebellious nation to tell me that regardless of who I was and what I had done in the past, He still had a plan for me. I had no idea where this plan was going to take me, but He gave me enough faith, enough strength to get through that one day. And the next, and then the next. My transformation was gradual, and God was convicting me of my dependencies. The most obvious was drugs. But within a few months, He completely delivered me from that. But the last thing that I was holding on to was my sexuality. As I was reading scripture, I couldn't get around the fact that God loved me unconditionally. But I also came across some passages which seemed to condemn homosexuality. So I went to a prison chaplain and I asked him his opinion on this issue. And to my surprise, this prison chaplain actually told me that the Bible does not condemn homosexuality. And so he went to his bookshelf and he got a book and he said, "This book explains that view." So, with much curiosity, I took that book in the hopes of finding biblical justification for homosexuality. I had that book in one hand and the Bible in the other. And from a purely human perspective, I had every reason in the world to accept what that book was claiming to justify the way I had been living. But God's indwelling Holy Spirit convicted me that those assertions from that book were a clear distortion of God, His Word, and His unmistakable condemnations against homosexual behavior. I couldn't even get through the first chapter of that book, so I gave the book back to the chaplain. So I turned to the Bible alone. I went through every verse, every chapter, every page of scripture looking for justification for homosexuality. I never found any. So I was at a turning point, and a decision had to be made. Either abandon God and His Word and live as a homosexual by allowing my feelings to dictate who I was, or abandon homosexuality by liberating myself from my feelings and live as a follower of Jesus Christ. My decision was clear and obvious. I chose God. As the days and the weeks and the months of abstinence passed, I realized that my sexuality is not an inseparable aspect of who I am as a person. You see, I'd always thought that God loves me unconditionally and He doesn't want me to change. But I realized that unconditional love is not the same as unconditional approval of my behavior. You see, my identity should never be defined by my feelings. My identity is not gay or homosexual or even heterosexual for that matter. Because my identity as a child of the living God must be in Jesus Christ alone. God says, be holy, for I am holy. You see, I had always thought that the opposite of homosexuality was heterosexuality. But actually, the opposite of homosexuality is holiness. And God was telling me, don't focus upon your sexuality or your feelings, but focus upon living a life of holiness and living a life of purity. Because change is not the absence of struggles, but change is the freedom to choose holiness in the midst of our struggles. Because the ultimate issue is not what I'm struggling with. It's not my sexuality, but the ultimate issue is that I yearn after God in total surrender and complete obedience. As God began to help me to live this life of surrender and of obedience, He began to reveal His plan for my life, and He called me to full-time ministry while I was in prison. And I realized that it didn't matter where I was, whether in prison or out of prison, because my calling on life remained the same regardless of the location. And with that change of heart, God did another miracle, and He shortened my sentence from 6 years to 3 years, which is almost unheard of in the federal system. And so I realized that with only about a year left of my prison sentence, if I was going to continue on in ministry after prison, I'd better learn more about the Bible than just prison religion. So I called home collect to my parents, and I told them of my interest to go to Bible college. And I asked them to mail me an application to the only Bible college I had ever heard of, Moody Bible Institute. But there was silence. But there was silence on the other line, because I think they both dropped their phones. My parents mailed the application into prison, and I was so excited, filled out the application till I got to the bottom, where they asked me for references from people who knew me as a Christian for at least 1 year. I was only able to persuade a prison chaplain, a prison guard, and another prison inmate to write my references to Moody Bible Institute. So the greatest miracle of this whole story is that Moody accepted me. I was released from prison in July of 2001, and I started the very next month. So imagine the surprise of my classmates when I answered their question, what did you do this summer? I graduated from Moody in 2005, and I went on to get my Master of Arts in Biblical Exegesis from Wheaton College Graduate School in 2007. And God has such a sense of humor, because now I'm back at Moody teaching in the Bible department. So I went from prisoner to professor. How about that for a resume? But God has done far more abundantly beyond all that we have asked or thought. As I look back upon the years that I've lived, most of which were far, far apart from Christ, I see a lot of bad decisions with some big consequences. One of those being HIV positive. But I realized something, that actually, I am no different than any of you. All of our days are numbered. Not one person in this room is promised tomorrow. And yet it took getting HIV for me to realize that as a child of the living God, I must live with a sense of urgency. You see, the God of the universe, the Almighty God, creator of the heavens and the earth, is calling us. He's calling you. He's calling me to partner with him, to bring this glorious message of Jesus Christ and him crucified. And yet, our days are numbered, and we must live with a sense of urgency. Are you willing to go if he says go? Are you willing to be a prayer warrior no matter what the situation or circumstance? Are you willing to say, here am I, send me?
Amen.
Because whether you are ready or not, in the blink of an eye, every one of us in this room will one day stand before our God, before our Creator. And my prayer is that He'll be able to look at you in the eye and say, well done, good and faithful servant. Thank you.
All glory be given unto the Lord. 来，我们一起为他们一家来祷告，奉主的名来祝福他们。Let's bow our heads and let us pray for this wonderful family who testify of the amazing love and grace of the Lord.